Let's take a look at some symbolic interactionist theories of deviance. So in other words, a micro-sociological perspective, we're going to take a look at some theories which seek to explain deviance from the standpoint of the focus on the concentration of individuals. The very first one we're going to take a look at is differential association theory. Basically, the idea is that we learn our attitudes about deviant behavior from the various groups that we associate with in society. So in other words, individuals' attitudes about what is or is not considered deviant, or whether or not they're going to engage in deviant behavior or not, are going to be primarily influenced by the types of groups that they join. So in our last module, when we talked about social groups, we talked a lot about the importance of primary, especially primary, but also primary and secondary groups in influencing our behavior. And differential association theory just applies that to our attitudes about what's deviant. So one of the best examples, and we talked a little bit about gangs in the last module, so we're going to kind of keep going with that theory. But if you were coming at why do individuals act in deviant ways from a differential association theorist or theory point of view, what you'd be looking at is, okay, if an individual is committing deviant behavior, the explanation you'd be looking for is what type of social groups has that person been associated with, and how have those influenced that individual's attitudes about deviance. So again, gangs is a very clear example, and we talked about gangs being in a lot of cases a form of primary group. So we would imagine that a person who associates quite a bit with gangs is going to demonstrate a lot of antisocial or purposely deviant behavior, breaking a lot of rules, again, drugs and crime and vandalism, violence would all be considered deviant behavior. And when we look at the influence of gang membership on that behavior, it's because the gang is reinforcing notions within itself about those type of behaviors in society. The flip side of that coin is you could use an organization like scouting. So we could say, okay, children who grow up in an environment in which they're actively participating in scouting are probably going to come away with much different attitudes about society and its rules and what's deviant and what isn't. So if we look at some of the tenets of scouting, we look at things like patriotism and productivity, and to a large degree, and sometimes when we ask about Girl Scouts, the first thing we're associated with is cookies and selling cookies, again, capitalism. So when we look at all those types of behaviors and we look at the people who engage in scouting versus gangs and then look at their behavior in relationship to society's rules, we can clearly see that a major influence on how they behave are the social groups that they associate with. So we can talk about the influence of things like families, neighborhoods, subcultures that people join, either born into or join voluntarily as they go through society, and that the choice of groups determines people's attitudes toward rules and norms in society. Okay? The second symbolic interactionist theory we're going to take a look at is control theory. Basically, this just says that there's a conflict kind of going on inside of us between our desire to do things that feel good, so almost back to that Freudian concept of an id, okay? And that's weighted against what we sometimes call inner and outer controls. So an inner control we can kind of broadly define as being a person's perception of what's right and wrong, again, according to the rules of society. Their influence or their what their behavior will do to affect other people, in other words, we can call it empathy or a conscience. So we have this sense of what society, what we feel like we should do, as opposed to then what we also call outer controls, the knowledge of consequences. So we know that if we, sometimes it's kind of, people use that term, act as if you're doing the right thing without anybody watching. So we might say, okay, I can get away with it, but I'm going to act in a proper way anyway. We're referring to inner controls, whereas if you just say, well, I'm not going to do that because I think the chances of getting caught are too great, we're generally referring to outer controls. So again, knowing what the rules of society and the consequences could be for certain types of behavior. So within us, we have this balance, okay, between inner and outer controls. But once again, from a sociological standpoint, are we born with that? And the answer is clearly no. Again, looking at feral children, like we talked about in the earlier module, the wild boy of Averone demonstrated almost absolutely no controls whatsoever, either inner or outer controls. When we combine those things, we call them self-control. So when we look at a feral child, we say that child clearly lacks self-control, has absolutely no concept of the influence they have on other people, nor what society's rules are. And the lack of both of those things results in a lack of self-control. So where do we as human beings gain self-control? Well, according to control theorists, we gain self-control as a product of our socialization, module 3. So if we talk about, again, how important in socialization is, it's because one of the things, again, according to control theorists, would be that we gain self-control through all the attachments, commitments, involvements, and beliefs we gain from being properly socialized in society. So, once again, if you are, we look at all those agents of socialization that we talked about, family, school, friends, religion, all those things, to a certain degree, one of the goals of each of those agents is to teach us, quote-unquote, right from wrong, or at the very least, what the rules of society are. So if we understand the rules of society, and we also understand how we interact with other people, then we're going to have inner and outer controls, which is going to result in a high measure of self-control. An interesting kind of a side note to the idea of self-control or control theory is the idea of the use of shaming as a way of a social control that is used sometimes to deal with people who are exhibiting very little self-control. You'll occasionally hear about this in the news or see it played out in the media where, let's say, for instance, a judge. There was a rather infamous case of a woman driver who consistently in the neighborhood or community that she lived in would ignore the stop sign on school buses and pull around them, sometimes, in fact, in one situation, I think driving up on a sidewalk to try to get around a parked school bus that was letting children out. Clearly, most of us regard that as a pretty serious behavior, and despite the fact that she was ticketed several times and arrested once or twice, she kept doing the behavior. Clearly, what that person is signaling to society is, I don't care how my behavior affects you, and I don't care what your rules are. And in that particular case, that person was sentenced to wear a large placard, one of those sandwich boards you sometimes see in advertising, and stand in a place near where a lot of cars would be, with the description of behavior, I ignore school bus signs, or I endanger children, or I forget whatever the sign said, and was sentenced literally to stand there 8 hours a day for a week, and then you can clearly imagine if you were one of those people driving by and saw somebody wearing that sign, you probably wouldn't be very kind to that person, and then the idea being that, again, in the judge's mind, we're going to shame this individual into recognizing that her lack of self-control is unacceptable to the rest of society. Again, Nathaniel Hawthorne's famous novel, The Scarlet Letter, was also an example of this. So the protagonist, Hester, had to wear a huge Scarlet A embroidered on her clothing for having broken the rule of adultery in the society or community that she lived in. So we see that sometimes shaming is a tool of social control, specifically associated with control theory. The very last one we have listed up here is labeling theory. Again, this looks at the idea or the effect of labels on individuals. Again, we can see why this fits into symbolic interactionism. A label is exactly that. It's something with an attached meaning. It's a name or a reputation attached to an individual, which is going to then influence that person's behavior. So again, the example that I use quite a bit is within schools. If you were talking to a large, following a cohort of children through school, so in other words, following them from kindergarten all the way up, one of the things you could look at is the labels that are attached to children a lot of times in school settings. So in a kindergarten class, again, not to say that every instructor does this, but certainly we know that a lot of times, instructors are prone to kind of asserting their own and attaching labels. So you've got the quiet kid, and you've got the class clown, and you've got the bully, and you've got the pain in the butt kid. So all these are labels. They're just symbols attached to people. But we also know, and many of you probably have either taken early education classes or human development classes, know that one of the things you should never do is attach negative labels to children. Why? Because children tend to then grow into those labels. So if you call a child a bad kid or a dummy, or conversely, you can actually say, this kid's really well behaved or smart, they'll tend to grow into those labels. Okay? That's one of the reactions we have to labels. However, that's not to say that labels are all powerful. Certainly people can neutralize or negate labels by rejecting them. An example I give about this a lot of times is in my experience working with adolescents, especially in correctional settings. Again, I'll sometimes say, what's a label that's often attached to kids who get in trouble with the law? And you'll most often hear juvenile delinquent. It's my experience that you talk to 100 kids in a correctional setting and ask any of them who's a juvenile delinquent, you'll routinely never see anybody's hand go up, or if you ask them directly, are you a juvenile delinquent? The answer is uniformly, usually, no, I'm not. So that's an example of a person's ability to reject labels. Sometimes we actually look at the idea that people can embrace labels, even negative ones, take them to heart. So once again, we usually think about it as embracing positive labels, and we certainly hope that a lot of, like I said, children especially, are given a lot of positive encouragement and meant to feel that they are accomplishing things and are capable of things, and they embrace those labels. But even negative labels can sometimes be embraced. Once again, sometimes we'll ask people if they've ever seen a symbol that looks like this. And most people will have seen it. We'll say, yeah, that's the 1% symbol, and I'll usually ask them where they've seen it. Some people will say, I've seen it on, associated with motorcyclists or motorcycle bike gangs, that kind of stuff. And that's absolutely right. The 1% symbol, you often see it on embroidered on motorcycle jackets or vests. And then I usually ask people if they know what it means, and some people would say we're the 1%, and meaning kind of like outlaw motorcycle riders, and that's absolutely correct. But then I ask, do you know where that origin of that label comes from? In the 1950s and 60s, when motorcycle riding was becoming very popular in the United States, the motorcycle industry itself was starting to worry, especially with increase of gangs, especially in California, like gangs like the Hells Angels, other outlaw gangs, that their product, motorcycles, was getting a bad reputation. And an example of kind of biased research, the American Motorcycle Association hired a research firm to conduct a survey of motorcycle riders. And again, because it was being sponsored by the American Motorcycle Association and backed up by motorcycle manufacturers, you can imagine the results kind of came out skewed. They definitely said that in the conclusions, one of the statements made was 99% of all motorcycle riders in the United States are law-abiding citizens. So if 99% are law-abiding citizens, who's the other 1%? And how did they react to that statement being made about them? They put it on a patch and proudly wear it on their uniforms. Okay? So the idea of embracing even a negative label as a sign of pride absolutely can let us know how important labels are. But again, in reaction or in association here with what we've been talking about as far as deviance, the labels that can be applied on us socially have a lot to do with our not only reaction. actions to deviance, but also our behavior.